Can I start now?
Sure.
Okay. Remember, this morning, we already get the information for the total payment. Is there anyone get this number here?
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be exactly this number.
Oh, yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Everyone get this?
This should be the sum.
Okay, now we want to do it multiple times, the simulation multiple times, so that we can find out what's going on for each simulation for the total payment. Let's first look at the result. Okay, this is the result I did before. We can see when I do press F9, we can see it will change. This is a histogram for the total payment of each simulation. You can see for 100 simulations, the total payment is, let's say, is around 8,000. It's about 10 times. Okay? So you can see the range of the total payment is about from 3,000 to 10,000. Okay? So that when you are work in an insurance company, they want you to estimate what is the total payment estimate. You have to estimate the total payment. Give them the analysis of the total payment. Okay, you can see from this histogram that the total payment is hardly to get more than 15,000, right? But there's some probability that it can, get beyond the 15,000. Okay? When we do this, we can see the most time the total payment is around 8,000. So that we can get a general idea of the distribution of the total payment. How can we get this? First, we list from 1 to 100. This is the times you want a simulation. Okay? And then here is the total payment. Here, we let it equals to sum of this one, of this column. This is the total payment, right? And then enter. Okay? This is one simulation. Can see? Now we want it to be 100 times, so we want to fill in all the blank. Here, we first highlight these two columns without the head, without the first row. Remember? Okay? Let's go to... Okay. Then we choose data. Okay, then choose what if analysis. Okay, data table. Okay, here, since we list the 100 times of simulation results to be a column, so we choose the column input cell. This means we want to fill in all the cells here by changing the input here. From we know how to calculate the total payment. The total payment is this times this, and then sum them up, right? The only there are two random variables in this total payment. The one is the death. They have some random variables, right, in the days. And there's also random variables in the payment. But both of them is random variables. It will change by itself. You don't need to specify, let's say this is 0.9 and you want to change it to be 0.6. You don't want to specify it. The computer will do it for you, okay? And then here, we are just going to choose this for a cell, empty cell. That's enough. And then Okay? Pressure, okay. Okay? We're going to see the computer already simulate 100 times for you. Can everyone do this? Okay, I will redo it. Okay, we got one of them. Then we highlight these two columns. Okay. See? Then we choose data. What is analysis? Data table. When we put it here, columns into the cell. And then choose whatever. Okay?
Data table.
This. Then okay. We don't need to choose the row column input. There's no row column input. Okay? Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Let me see. Some of you don't have this. You need to put in some add-in files. You have already got this. Yeah. They already have it. No, you have to put in the first one. Equals to first one. No. This one. Yeah, equals to sum of the total the payment. You didn't do this.
Okay.
Sum of this from this. Okay. Is there anyone okay with this? Okay. Then we count the number of simulations.
What's
Let's rename this as simulation. Okay. Then equals to count. Simulation. Okay. Then similarly, the same as we did in the first sheet. This is average of simulation. Okay? And similarly, we can get the max of simulation. We can get the minimum of simulation. We can also get the variance, the standard deviation. I just get the standard deviation. Okay. And then the sample standard error. Do you remember what is sample standard error? This should equals to standard deviation over the square root of 100, right? Okay. And now, what's the degree of freedom should be? 100 minus 1 should be 99. The t value here, we use tinv. The first one is the probability, should be 1 minus 0.95. Okay? And the second one is the degree of freedom, 99. Then enter. Okay? Now we have get the confidence interval of total payment. It should be, this is the upper bound, should be equal to the average top plus the key value times the sample standard error, right? Okay, this is the upper bound. Now, similarly, we can get the lower bound, which should be the average minus p value times sample standard error. Okay. So we can see that for 100 simulations, the total payment is more than 6,800, is less than 7,800. So it seems that the total payment is around 7,000, right? So from this, we can give some information of the total payment. Okay, can everyone get the confidence interval now? Okay. Now we are going to a histogram. Do you remember the frequency, the formula of frequency? Here I already give you the bins. Okay, it's from 0 to 20,000. First, highlight this column. Let it equals to frequency. This is the data. The data is we renamed it as simulation. And then the bin should be from 500 to this, right? Then control shift enter. Okay. First, highlight this column. Okay. Then equals to frequency. The first parameter is the data. We name the data as simulation, right? Simulation. Comma. Then is the bins. Okay. The bins. I think you. In your Excel, the critical points is already listed there, right? Then you can choose from 500 to the 19,500, okay? And then close it, okay? Then press Control Shift. And enter. Okay, can anyone? Do you have any questions of this?
Oh, I do. Yeah, I'm not getting the same numbers you're getting for.
Oh.
Oh wait, M41. Okay. Okay. Oh, and then M3, wait, what? It keeps changing it. I type in M3 and then M41 and then it changes when I, oh wait, Control Shift.
Control Shift.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's,
No, it's just doing not right.
Oh, do I have to do the dollar signs then, right?
Where? Sorry?
Oh, yeah. Should I put dollar signs in front of the end and...
No.
Oh, okay, then why is it...
You should first highlight.
Oh, wait.
You should do it, redo it again.
Oh, okay. So,
I'm going to have to... Highlight all the columns. Okay. Equals to...
Is it equals? Okay.
Equals to...
Yeah.
Simulation. And then choose from 500.
Okay, so 500.
2, 1. Yep. Close it. Yeah, control shift enter.
Okay.
Okay. Right,
thank you.
Okay. Yeah, any questions? Okay. Alright. I'm trying to. Here is not simulation. This is 1 minus.
The confidence level?
Yeah. Yeah, come on.
It's a simulation though.
Yeah, and then 99. Yeah,
that's
true.
So why did you say
can you rename this information? You can just do this as 1 minus 0.95. Then you don't need to choose that cell. Okay. You cannot do that. First, this is the IRA formula. You should highlight all the columns first, okay, then equals to frequency.
It is
then you should control shift. Control shift. Yeah, that's true. Okay. So, for those who already got the frequencies, now you can histogram this. Okay? First highlight the frequency, then insert column. Okay? This is the same thing we already done, right? This is now you can see what the histogram changes by press F9. You can see. Okay, this is the idea of the simulation, so that you can give analysis of the total payment. Okay. thing. So do you have any questions of all the above? Okay. How long it goes to mean the average? The average is already got
class. What time do you want to
class, class, center,
arrow. Tell him it's all there. Click on top of it. Then you highlight the wanna. Drag it and bring all the way down to 100. Go to what analysis.
And this is the average of minus.
Data, go to data. Right, press OK.
Hello everyone.
Hello.
You doing fine?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so I have some fun. And that will be four problems that I will do today. And each one will be about 30 minutes. I'll go over the model first for maybe 10 to 15 minutes. And then I'll go over the Excel, 5 to 10 minutes. And then maybe I'll give you some exercise to do. So it's going to be very challenging problems. Oh. So the first problem that I'll do is actually the one that I have been to the company about the internship. So actually I used this one for the Renry internship. And it's a good basic for you to understand the model and also how do you use it in Excel. Okay? So has anyone did the option pricing before? Anyone? 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Did you do it in Excel before?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. So maybe it's a good review for you guys then. Okay? All right. So I'll give you the model. So you have a stock price, start at S0. And then the stock will move up or down for each time period. Okay, that's the assumption. And then you update the stock price based on this relation. Okay? Which means the stock that goes up will be the from the previous time multiplied by the up factor. And the stock that goes down will be the stock previous time multiplied by the down factor. And then you keep doing that for each node. And then, okay, so I'll give you an example. Let's say the stock start at time 0 at $10. And then the up factor is 2, and the down factor is 0.5. Okay? So let's work on the board.
little bit less in here.
Okay.
Maybe just display in the bottle.
Mm-hmm.
Display in the bottle.
Yeah, but it's gonna smell really bad. That's why I don't want to use it.
We can't see anything.
You can see it, right? No.
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 If you make something else.
Oh. Let me try it.
Okay.
And see if you can. Okay. So, S 0 will be what? 10. U would be 2, right? And then D would be 0.5.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So at time T equals to 0. Okay? Can you see it?
Mm-hmm.
Over there, can you see it? Okay. At time 0, the stock will be 10. And then you update from the relation that T plus 1 up will be U times ST, and then ST plus 1 down will be D times ST, right? So the up will be what? What should be the up stock price?
20,
right? Because you multiply 10 by 2, right? The U is 2, so it's 20. And then what should be the lower one? 5, right? Because 10 times D, which is 0.5, is 5.
Mm-hmm.
This is time 1. Okay? Easy, right?
Yes.
Yeah. See, option pricing is easy. Oh, yeah, no?
No.
Okay. All right. And then, what is this then? Now you can do it.
40.
40?
This?
10. Good. How about this?
10.
10?
Yes.
And then this one will be what?
0.5.
Here we go. So, but most of the time, a lot of financial engineer, they will just cobble this number because it's always going to produce the same number, right? Because why? Because this 10 multiplied by U, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you multiply by D here. That's why you get 10.
Okay.
Then this one you multiply by D.
Mm-hmm.
And you multiply by U. So you multiply by the same thing. So you should get 10. So you just, instead of writing the whole thing here, you write 20, 5, then 10. 40, and then 2.5. Okay? Alright, that's good. 0, t plus 1, t plus 2. 2. Okay? So let's build this in Excel. How are we going to build it in Excel? So let's bring up the binomial for students. Here we go. So let's see. So the first prize would be 10, right? Okay. And then the next one, you can see that I do it in this way. The triangular is going down this way because if you want to do it this way, then there are going to be a lot of problems because the thing will crash to each other. So we'll do it this way, just like a triangular. Okay, so this one here will represent the node 20. Okay, so it's up. So we do this guy. Oops, should be Let me call this, let me call it U, okay? And then let me call this number D. Okay? Then this will be just 10 multiplied by what? U, right? And then this will be just 10 multiplied by D. Okay? So it's exactly the same as the tree that I draw over there. Now, you do the same for this. This is going to be what? It's going to be the stock price from the previous period, which is 20, right? Look at the... I'm trying to get this node right here. So I look at the node right here, 20, and then I multiply by U. Okay. Multiply by U. Okay, that's what we get. And then, any questions up to here? Any questions? No? Okay. So, for this one, you will do what? This is going to be the node 10, right? But you have two choices. You can multiply 20 by D or multiply 5 by U, right? Correct? But it's easier to just do 20 multiplied by D, and you will see why. So let's do 20 multiplied by D. Okay, and then for this one too, it's going to be 5 multiplied by D. Okay, good. Any questions? No? Okay, pretty straightforward for the binomial tree. You have a question? Okay. Now, the techniques that you want to use is this. Okay. You start with 10. I'll do another tree. Because if you price the option, you just don't want to do just 2-time period, right? You want to do more and more and more step. This is how you make it more. Make it faster. So you multiply by U, and then this one you multiply 10 by D. Okay? And you don't just type it here, but you can just do this. You can just copy and then drag to copy the formula. There we go. See? And then from here, from this node here, you drag down. See, so you don't need to type at time 3 anymore. You can just copy it. You wanna do it one more time?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. All right, let's do it again. So remember this, you do it time by time, column by column.
Okay. Can you go back one more step, please?
One more step?
Yeah.
Sure. Let's do it again. So it's going to be 10 multiplied by what? U, right? It's going up. That's the upper node. How about this one? What is it? It's this node, right? It's the previous price, 10, multiplied by D. Yeah. But you know that this cell right here has to multiply by U too. Right?
Yes.
That's why, and this one has to multiply this by D, right? Yes. That's why I just copy the formula. So you select these two cells, and then you do drag it up to here. Okay? Can anyone follow? Yeah?
Yep. I didn't, when I, when I drag the cells, I got zeros. Here, let me show you.
Oh, because you need to specify D, because right now you multiply by C4, and when you drag it, C4 is going to move here.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, be careful here. This is a good problem that you should have sometime. This is what he did. So he did. So he did this price.
Okay.
And then he multiplied by this cell U. D. I'm sorry. D. Right. And then he drag it. Then he got the wrong number. Why? You know why? Why?
He didn't put the right formula in.
Hmm?
The reference, he didn't put the right form, the cell number.
Yeah, because when you multiply, here.
Yeah.
Let's see. Oops, sorry. Yeah, this is, I said the wrong thing. It should be. I should do.
No,
I
don't see.
It should be C. Oh, it doesn't do it. Let me just do it here. 2. The upper factor is 2, and the down factor is 5.5. And then let's do this multiplied by the upper factor. Okay, it should be 20. This is right, right? But when he drag it, this is what he get. He got 0. Why? Why?
Cell switch.
Huh?
Cell switch.
Which cell?
D.
U, right? Yeah.
U,
that's a good answer. Because, see this. This is right, because you multiply 10 by 2, right? But at this cell, it's 20 multiplied by something else, see? Because you didn't fix the parameter, okay? So that's what you have to be careful when you do the binomial tree, okay? That's why the first time I specified this to be U, because I want to fix it, and it's not going to move. And this one I specify D. Okay? You got the idea, right?
Mm-hmm. So yeah. Like just an idea to see how it looks like when you have 100 stock prices, mm-hmm. you have 2 or 3
mm-hmm.
How are we gonna do like time one time? I didn't do this pricing, but I did this black horse.
You will see the pricing, later on. But right now, I want you guys to, let's see, I'll give you guys 5 or 10 minutes and try to extend it maybe for t equals to 5. Let's do it. Let's build a tree for t equals to 5 or t equals to 10. How are you going to do it? Using this exactly the same.
Yes.
When I drag this one, and I look at the formula, I'm expecting this one to be 13. I know this is the correct answer, but why is this thing still?
This is right. Yeah. This cell
select
from this, not this. Because you look at the tree, it's 20 multiplied by D, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this one is go to. Say this cell should be 10. But how are you going to get 10? You have 2 choices. One is to multiply 20 by D, or the other one is 5. You choose
this one.
Why is this thing?
why, when I move this thing, when I move this thing to this thing, mm-hmm. to this space,
yeah.
I know that D will be fixed because yeah. before I fixed it, it's not. I do expect this thing to move to F, I mean, like from here, because I'm referencing from here. So when I come here, it should be G. But
yeah,
yeah. it's G. So why is it that the 12 is not 13? Because I'm expecting that one to move to.
Because look at the back one here, you have 5 here. Then go to this one right here. This one has come from one rest. It's one, click it F12 multiplied by D, right?
So each one you just this is not for this one, yeah, you just do that and then go to the bottom one, isn't it here? But then you get it then to the bottom one, just highlight that. So.
You've opened all of your
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
So is it working well?
Fine?
Okay. So let's see, I'll just do it and then let you check if it's right or wrong. Let's do... Okay. I just do the copy.
Yeah.
You don't have to type it.
You just select.
Wait, how do you do
that? You select all those ones.
But what are we doing on the second one? The second
column? You get the same answer?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. So that's how you generate the stock price for 6 years, for example.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know. Okay, I don't get the copy thing. How do you, what are you
supposed to do? Okay, like this is 10, right? For the first
one, right there.
Yes. And then
this
column is supposed to be.
Oh, you named
yours.
So it's
10.
This.
Mm-hmm. Good, yeah.
And then
this one will be 10.
Okay.
And now we do
that. Okay, wait, you can go like that, right? No.
So, here, no.
At
the
So, every time you end this, you just say 10. And then you extend it, so the last one.
So, then we can do the pricing.
Okay.
So after we get the tree, everyone has a tree, right? Happy? Okay, good. You have a tree. And then you can price the option now. Oh my god. Okay, good. So from this, this tree that we have before, let's say, just interrupt me if you have any question. Okay, so for example, let's say at time 2, you will have the payoff from the option, which is the maximum of the stock price subtracted by some number. It's called strike price, but it's a sum number, just some number. And 0. Okay, that's what you get. I will show you on the board in a minute. But the put is the opposite way. It's the maximum of K minus S and 0. Okay? But to compute the price for the call and the put, you need to calculate what is called the risk neutral probability. Okay? You don't use the real world
probability to do it, okay, for option pricing. And the P is defined by 1 plus R subtracted by D and divided by U minus D, right? Is this right? Yeah. Okay.
What is R?
R will be the interest rate. D, the down factor, U is the up factor. Okay. All right. Let's see. And this is how you price it. And you will see on the tree, this looks like very complicated, but when you look at the tree, it's easy, fun. So when you price the call option, you do it backward. It's called backward induction. You start at the terminal time, at time two, and then come back to time one, and then come back to time zero to get the price. Yes.
So does that mean you are treating R as an annual effective rate or something?
The
annual effective.
Annual, yes. Annual effective rate for 1 year. So this is how you do. You do the call of the up factor multiplied by the probability plus 1 minus P, which is the probability that you go down, okay? Multiplied by the CT of the down payoff. And then you discount by the risk-free rate, risk-free interest rate. Okay, let me do it here. So let's see, you have 10, 20, 5, 40, 10, and 2.5, right? Your tree, the stock price. The call option will be based on the stock price. So how much should I pay for the call option? So the call payoff at time 2 will be the max of S2 minus the strike price and zero. Okay. And the put option will be the max K, right? S2 and zero. Okay. And you have the risk neutral probability to be 1 plus R minus D. U minus D, right? And then the call option at time T minus 1 is going to be what? 1 over 1 plus R, and then P times CTU plus 1 minus P CTD. Okay. All right. So, look at time 2 first, right, when you price the option. What is the payoff here for the call option? Let's do call option first.
What's the strike price?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Let's say K equals to 10, R equals to 0.05. Okay, what else do I need? I don't need anything else. Okay. So, what is the payoff here for the call option? 30, right? Because the call 2 will be the max of what? 40 minus 10 and 0, right? Which is going to be max of 30 and 0, right? Okay. So max of 30 and 0 is just 30. Okay. Do the same thing for this. This is what? 0, right? And this is what?
Zero.
Zero? Okay. Any questions up to this point? Any questions? No? Okay.
Can it be zero instead of one perhaps?
This, for this one?
No, for the functions, the call and the pull. I understand how we got zero, but why do we use zero in the call and pull?
You mean this?
Yeah, why do we use zeros?
It's because of the nature of the call option. I mean, because they want to protect, it's like an insurance to protect the downside of the stock option.
Okay.
the stock price. You, for call option, you can buy the stock. Yeah, that's why I don't want to get into this because it might be long. But it's, you can think of, if you buy a call option, then you can buy a stock at a given price K. It's like an insurance. You fix the price at the future.
So
time
why
T.
Are those zeros?
This one, because
yeah.
C2 here, it's like a max of 10, right? This is stock price here. Subtracted by 0, subtracted by 10 and 0, which is max of 0 and 0.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Okay. So you get the call option payoff at the terminal, right? Then you want to find the call option here. You do it backward until you get the call option at time right now. That's what you want to pay for the call option. Okay? So this one, we call it C1U. This one, we call it C1D. Okay? And then just plug into the formula here. So this one, C1U, will be what? 1 over 1.05, right? It's 1 plus R. Right? And then you multiply by the P here. P here we calculated to be, let's see. I'm not sure, maybe it's 0.3 or something.
0.36.
0.36?
Good.
0.36. So the P should be 0.36. And then you multiply by the terminal here, right? The up. Of the call option.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be 30, and then you plus 1 minus 0.36 multiplied by the payoff here, which is 0 of the call option. Okay? Then you should get about, let's see, should be 10.476. Okay? Any questions on this? So you do backward, like a triangle, from this and this to get this price. Okay? And this one too, just do, it's like an expected value, right? You multiply the price of going up by the probability, multiply the price of going down by the 1 minus the probability to get the expected value and then discount it. And then for C2D, you do the same thing. So 1 over 1.05.
I have a question. Is it C2D?
Let me zero.
It is no zero.
Should be zero.
Huh? Okay, C2D.
Oh, C1.
Okay.
Sorry. Yeah.
I have another.
Yes.
Do the numbers after the decimal, like, how much do they matter? Well, how many?
Because
I got a little bit different than the 4, 7, 6.
Yeah, it's if it's just third decimal here, it's okay.
I got
285
after the decimal.
285.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll check in the Excel again.
Okay.
Okay. And then you do for C0. Okay. So Z0, can you see it? Z0 will be what? Will be 1 over 1 plus R times the P C1U plus 1 minus P hat C1D. Right? And then you do the same thing. Triangle here. Discount the price here, the call here, and the call here, right? Do the same thing. See? It's like a triangle. Then you get. You should get about 3.65835. Okay? Whew. Alright, let's do an Excel. Yes?
In business, like in the real world, do you use effective rates or?
It depends. It really depends. Sometimes you use this for the real world, for the model. Sometimes you use what is called the interest rate dynamic, like a stochastic exchange. Yeah. Or sometimes you change this to be the exponential rate. Yeah. So it depends on the situation. Any question? Okay, let's do the Excel. So let me open the other one. So this, let's see. The probability, you need to calculate the probability, risk neutral probability first, which is going to be what? 1 plus
R,
and then subtracted by D, divided by U minus D. So that should be your risk neutral probability. Okay, it should be just the formula that I give. 1 plus R, so it's going to be 1 plus this cell subtracted by C5, which is D, right? And then everything divided by U, which is this cell, minus D, which is this cell. Okay? Any question for the probability? Okay. Then let me call this the up factor again. Oh, it used the same thing. So you don't have to call U and D again if you are in the same file, because it's already initialized U and D here from the previous worksheet. Okay, so you can just do U and D, you already specify it, but you need to change this to be R, right? This number to be R, okay? And this number to be K, capital K. Can everyone follow? So I just use this to be R.
Doing that to me too.
Yeah,
because of the
error.
This R.
Oh,
is the error?
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Capital R.
Maybe let me call it interest rate.
I.
Interest
I'm
gonna
change anyway.
R. Interest R. Okay. Yeah, maybe R is the reserve variable in Excel. That's why it doesn't take it. So let's call it interest rate. Interest R. And then let's call this K. Capital K. Okay, and let's build the stock price again. Let's do the stock price again. So this one is gonna be 10. You should be able to do it by now. Should be 10 times D. This should be the same. And then you just copy. Okay, stock price. And everyone builds it. Okay. So, everyone get the stock price set up? The tree?
Yeah?
Good. Then we need to calculate the terminal payoff at time two, right? So what is it? Do you know? It's going to be equals to what? Max, right? The max function. And then you pick this stock price, right? 40. Subtracted by what? K, the strike price. And 0. Correct? Should be 30, the same as the 3. Is this the same one? good.
Yeah. Could you do that again, please?
Yes, sure. It's going to be equals to, this is the payoff, right? It's the max of the S2 subtracted by K and zero.
Okay.
So it's going to be max of the stock price that we built, 40,
okay,
subtracted by K, capital K,
okay,
right? That's what we defined before.
Okay.
And zero.
Oh, okay.
Should give you 30.
Right. Okay.
Everyone gets that?
Yeah.
Minus
K.
K is
10. K is 10. Yeah, yeah, it's already defined, right?
Yeah.
And then what do you do for the rest here? It's the same formula, right?
Yeah.
You only need to change the price here. Right? You need to change just the price. So you just copy it down.
It was zero.
Right? You get that one more time?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, get it? Good?
Yeah.
You get a negative 7.5. Why?
Sorry.
Oh, you forgot. It should be comma and zero.
Yeah.
Okay.
Zero.
So, what is this? This should be what at this node?
1 over.
Okay. Should be 1
over
1 plus interest r, right? That we defined before. 1 over 1 plus r. Oh, yeah. 1 over 1 plus r. And then, let's make this to be all in the parentheses, right? That's the discount factor. Then you multiply by what? Multiply by parentheses. This number, right? Probability. Times the C before, which is going to be D19, right? So it's 1 over 1 plus R. And then multiply by C, which is going to be the probability here. Multiply by the cell before, right? Multiply by the cell before, which is the price at time 2 at U node. Okay? And then you add 1 minus the probability, right? From the formula up there, from the formula. 1 minus the probability, and then multiply by this cell right here, the down, right? The down. Down node, and that should do it. Can you follow? It's too fast.
Yeah.
Too fast. Okay, let's do it again. So let me copy this. So it should be 1 over 1 plus r, right? Multiply one over 1 plus R, and then
multiply
by P times C up plus 1 minus P C down. Right? That's the formula, right? That's the formula, right? That's the formula on the board, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you want to find 1 over 1 plus R, and then multiply by P, multiply by the CU, which is the C upper node, which is 30, plus 1 minus P, multiply by the C down, which is this node, right here. You see that? You see that formula? Okay. That's just what I'm doing. Yes?
What is the CU again? C upper again?
C? Think about this as the tree, right?
Yeah.
This is the tree that is here, right? So the CU is going to be here, and CD is going to be here, right? That's what I'm doing. That's all I'm doing is this formula. So you do 1 over 1 plus R, multiply by P that we calculate, and then multiply by the C up, which is 30.
Okay.
And then plus 1 minus b, and c tau is 0. Good?
Yeah.
Everyone is okay? Okay. Good. Okay. And actually, C here should be what?
Lock.
Huh?
F or lock.
Should be fixed. Right? Should be fixed. Because if you copy the formula down, it's going to change the cell. Right? So, you can put the dollar sign here. C is just the probability. CA is the probability. Or you can just do, if you have CA, you can just highlight it, press F4, and it's going to give you dollar sign. Okay. Next example will be much more fun, I promise. So this is a little bit tedious calculation. Yeah? Yeah, did you get it? Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Compared to that number, 10.47. Okay, so let's try. So that's what you get? Everyone? Is that what you get or not?
Yeah.
Okay. And then you see, for this node right here, you do basically the same thing as this node, right? You, for this node, they look at the value of C before, which is this and this, right? For this one, you look at this and this. For this node, you look at this and this. That's, so what do we do from this to this? You just copy, right? Yeah, just extend it. Good, you just copy down. And it should give you 0. So let's look at the board right there. The first value is 10.4 something, right? Which is the C1 that you get from here. And this one is here, which is 0. So it's the same value with the whole thing. Yeah. Yeah, it's P, yeah.
Oh, under
main handle. Yeah. You can define it to be P. Okay. And you see, it's the same, basically the same thing when you do backward, right? For this cell, you look at this node and this node. So if I want to look at here, I just look at this node and this node, right? These two nodes. So you just copy it again. Yes?
I would like to drag that top one, 10.47, drag it down, or we have to retype the formula again?
You just drag down, because it's the same process.
The same process?
Yes, same process, right? Because this guy, they use the value of here and here, and they use the same probability, use the same R.
Okay.
If you drag it down, the formula will be exactly the same, but it will use the value here and here. For this one?
Yeah.
Just copy again. Yeah. Because this one we use this node and this node.
Yeah.
Which is, if you do it, if you move forward a little bit, then it's gonna be this and this value. Yeah. Right? Good. Here we go. So that's what you should get for the price of the call option. Just copy from this to this. Good? Any questions?
Do you grab a copy? Just copy?
You can, I think you can copy it too, or you can drag it. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. You can just copy it. Because the cell will move. All right, I'll give you 5 minutes to do the put option. Can you do the put option now? Yeah, let's do it. So the put option, what is the difference here? The difference will be the payoff at the end. Instead of S minus K, right? You need to do K minus S.
Okay.
All right, let's do it. 5 minutes.
Oh, I'm still working on that.
Any question, just raise your hand and that will be Chahu and Jinjin helping you. Finish. You can try to do
yes
multiple times if you want to have fun. Let's say you want to do like t equals to 6. No, you don't want to do. And then just do backward, copy and copy.
Yeah.
Huh?
Okay. Yeah. So
you can try and then see how the caution at the terminal time we pay and then just count backward. So it's the same process. So let's see.
Actually, I'm back from my class, so we had this type of Excel stuff for
wait, I got something different.
Oh, really?
Okay, what did you get?
It's on the internet.
You need to share.
So it's the maximum of
K minus S. So double click. Yeah, see, it doesn't reference to your stock price.
Oh, okay.
That's why.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
No, I'm just getting the wrong answer.
Yeah.
Okay, so everyone gets the same answer?
That's the answer for the food option.
But this was it.
Yeah, I did. It's called, yeah, it calls K.
Oh, because this one is not 0.7.
Yeah.
Oh, the parentheses. Don't forget to the parentheses here. Let me do the pricing.
Look at the formula.
This one, I think, it doesn't refer to the stock price here. It refers to here. Right? Because when you copy it down, it should refer to the stock price here. The stock price is the trees here. See? It should be
K minus
40 here. But now it's... Oh, yeah.
You're welcome.
So, I think everyone is pretty much done. Let me move on to another topic. Okay. You can try it at home. More fun. Like 100, and then you have a nice sleep tonight, and then... But I just want to say that every time that you do pricing or something, Excel can be very useful. You can start here and see what is going on, and then you use MATLAB or anything to price. Just start your idea here, and it's very useful. Yes?
Okay, so I'll start at and then work the way backwards.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so, when you're paying for option where it has tables 1, 4.5, 2, what does that mean?
Where is it?
Right here?
Yes. What does that mean?
It means just the call value at that time, but you cannot exercise it at time equals 1. It's just the value of the call. Because right now your stock price is like 20, right? So you have more than the K, more than the strike price. So if you have more stock price than the K, then the call value is about this. That's the interpretation.
So basically,
the tree is like a path. One can be this path, one can be this path. Okay? All right, let me do another example. By the way, hello. Now it's time to get... do you have any do you have Excel solver in your computer? Excel solver. Okay.
Hopefully a lot of people might not have this.
Okay, this is how you get the solver, Excel solver. We need it for the next example. Click right here. Okay. And then go to the customize. Okay, okay. One more. Right here, right here. On this bar. Right here. Click right.
Okay.
Click right.
Okay.
And then customize. Okay. And then you go to add-ins. Okay. Did you get it?
No, I didn't.
You don't have add-in?
So at this bar, right click.
Yes. And then, oh no, not the up there. Just around here. Everyone get to this point? Yeah?
Yes. My version, I have 2010, so
okay.
When I click on that bar, it gives me something else.
Oh, right click on where you see like data, or right click on the word itself, and you'll see that
the word find and then
customize. Customize quick access.
Yeah.
Quick access.
Yeah.
Okay. Then you do add-ins, and then you do Excel add-ins, and then go. See? And then click on the solver add-ins. Good. So you have one? So okay, and then you click OK. If you have one. If you don't have one, it's going to install it for you.
Yeah, so after I click add-ins, click
add-in.
Right.
Click add-in, and then you click go, and then click on solver.
Okay.
And then OK.
All right, I got it.
Just click on here too. Check it. Check the solver. Then click OK.
So it's
now everybody have it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go down.
Yeah. No? If you don't have it, maybe you can share it with other people.
Oh, okay.
Maybe you can work with other people. Just share your computer with other people. Okay, let's look at this. There we go. We are done with this. So we are gonna do optimization with Excel. Good. Because my background is in operation research, so that's why I have done a lot of optimization. But we use something else. But I know that Excel can do something too, which is interesting. So I just want to share with you.
What's the other program you use?
I think it's called Lingo. Yeah. It's like combinatory analysis stuff. And AMPO. It's similar to the mathematics program Maple, but it's called AMPO, which is specialized for operation research. Okay, here we go. So Apple products are magical. They are magical. So they are in high demand. Tim Cook, the CEO of it, wants to produce like iPod, iPhone, and iPad. As much as possible per month. So there are three machines that are required to produce these three products. So. But the problem is, these three machines, they have only 400 hours per month to operate for machine A. And for machine B is 300 hours. Machine C will be 150. So he wants to produce as much as possible per month. How much should he produce for each product? That's the question. Everyone get the question? Yeah, optimize. So you can formulate the problem in this way. Yeah. Yes.
Yep.
Okay, are you ready? Formulation of the problem. So let's say you want to produce X1, which is, let's call this the iPod. Okay, plus X2, this is the iPhone. And then plus X3, which is iPad. Okay? So this X1, X2, and X3 are called decision variables. So you want to maximize that. Tim Cook, you want to maximize it. But for each iPod, they require this machine A 3 hours to produce, and machine B 4 hours to produce. And for iPhone too, and iPad. So for machine A, this is the constraint. So such that, okay, three, right? You need 3 hours for the iPod, for machine A. This is machine A. 3 hours, X1, right? Plus 5 hours for the iPhone, and then 3 hours for the iPad. But this thing has to be less than or equals to what? 400, yeah. Because the maximum time that you can produce for this machine is 400, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, good. Then B. Machine B, now you can help me. What is it?
4x1
plus 4x3? 300. What is the other one?
2x2.
2x2. Oh, let me write. 2 plus
3x3.
3x3 less than or equals to? Okay. And what else that we need to restrict our problem?
X plus E, the X1, X2, and X3 greater than equal to 0.
Exactly. That's right. Yes. Every one of them cannot be negative, right? You don't want to produce negative iPhone. So, X1, X2, X3 has to be greater than or equal to 0. Correct? Okay, so that's what you want to do. Let's do it in Excel. How much should I produce? Let's open the other worksheet.
I mean, we need to have a bit of that.
So I'll put all the machine here. Okay? I'll put the right hand side, it's called right hand side. Okay. We call it available time. Okay. And let me call this cell is gonna be the initial guess. Like how much I'm gonna produce. Okay? It can be 20, 20, 20. Okay? So, but this is actually X1, right? Correct? Mm-hmm. This is actually X2. And this is actually X3. So, if I produce this much, what is the required time? To produce for each machine. Okay, so it's gonna be what? It's gonna be the iPod, right? Times X1, for machine A, I'm calculating machine A right now. Then plus iPhone times the iPhone here, X2, plus 3 times 20, right? So that is the time required for machine A to produce this much. Did you get that? Did you get that idea?
Yeah.
Yeah? You will see if I change it, the number will change. The number that machine A has to run will change. Okay? So, but you don't want to, I want to copy the formula, so I need to fix something. So it's going to be B18 that it has to fix. I have to fix here, right? Because when I copy down this formula right here, I don't want this to go down. That's why I need to fix B18. And then what else? C18. And then? B18. Enter. Okay? So that's the required time for this machine to operate for this amount. You can see that if you want to produce, let's say, 100 iPhone, 100 iPod, what's wrong with it? What's wrong with this? Yeah, that's right. Because the total time that machine A has to run for this production is 860. Too much, right? You have only 400. Okay? So you cannot do this. You need to have, let's say, 20. So this is fine, right? 20 is fine. But you, on the other hand, you don't want to produce this much. Although this is less than this, because of what? Yeah, because you want to maximize the total production, right? Okay, do you get that?
Yeah.
Good, then you can just copy this now. Okay. Now the most important part is solver. You set up the problem already. So you need to go to, I think, data. Go to data. The reason that we need to calculate this, because we want Excel to know what is going on between this number and this number. That's the reason that I calculate here. Okay, because we need to input that into the solver. Okay? So let's open solver. Open the solver. Then you can... What is the target cell? Ooh. The target cell is your objective function. But now you don't have the objective function yet. So you need to specify it. Let's go. Let's close solver for now. The objective function is to get the total, to maximize the total amount here, right? Total amount of production. So you do what? You do equal sum of all the production, right? So the total production is 60. Okay? That's what you want to maximize. So let's go to, everyone get that? Is it too fast? Too fast?
Oh,
okay, I'll slow down a little bit.
Did you get
this number?
Yeah.
Good?
Yeah.
Everyone has any?
Yeah.
I get the server.
The
I do data.
You mean this one? Oh, the solver. You go to data.
I'm trying to
solve. Tab.
It's not
oh, maybe he can share. We can share here.
I'll probably share. This.
Yeah, yeah. If you don't have solver, you share with someone else. Okay, just to be quicker. So you go to solver. All right, let's open solver. Solver. Then you map. Your target cell will be this. Click here. Enter. By changing the cell, so. The changing cell here will be your decision variables. Okay? So you change just tell Excel what you want to change, which is this number, right? Correct?
Correct.
Get it or not?
Okay.
No, definitely not.
You want to maximize? You want to maximize the total output, right? That's your objective function right here. By changing all of these variables here. So you want to change x1, x2, and x3 to maximize your objective function.
Okay.
Right? So that's why you,
How did we get to solver?
Data tab, and then solver. If you don't have it, share with your friend. Okay. And then here again. By changing this cell right here. Okay? You get that? And then you do, this is gonna be your constraints. So the first constraint is that what? What is our constraint right there? Yeah, everything, let's do this first, right? This is easy one. Everything here has to be greater than or equal to zero, which is positive. So, okay, let's do it again. Let's go add, and then the reference, which is gonna be 20, right? All of them, all of the x1, x2, and x3 has to be greater than or equal to zero.
Yeah.
So you keep, you press enter, and then you do greater than or equal to, and then you do zero. If it's a, if you want this one to be greater than or equal to one, this one to be greater than or equal to zero, this one has to be greater than or equal to three, then the right hand side can be all the cells here too.
Oh, okay.
Did you get that? Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be just one number. This one means all the variables here has to be greater than or equal to zero because it has the same condition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Alright. Then you do add. Click add. Okay, so that first constraint is add to your problem, to your solver. What is the next constraint? About the machine, right?
Machine.
So, but we calculate this one right here, this cell right here, we already calculate this, right? Right? We already calculate this. And the second line is this. And this, right? And the right hand side we know from that is 400, right? And this is 300, and this is 150. So you want to compare between this column and this column.
Okay.
Right? Good. Let's do it. So the left hand side will be of this value here. Just drag down all the thing. And then the right hand side, less than or equal, will be this. Then enter. Okay? For the last constraints, you don't click add, you click OK. Oh, don't crash. Okay. Good. Alright, so that's our problem, right? We already tell Excel to do it. So let's solve it. Okay. So what does it say? It says that you need to produce 48.33 iPod, 35 iPhone, 26.67 iPad. Is there anything wrong with it? Yeah? What's wrong? Yeah. How are you gonna have like two-third iPad, right?
Yeah.
You don't like that. So what do? You go back round to solver.
Oh, I was just going to say round. Isn't there like a
yeah
round?
Okay. You can round it, but there's a... the other way of the operation research that you can do is called integer programming.
Oh, okay.
This one is... The first one that we did is called linear programming. It's just linear. X1, X2, and X3 can be fractions. But if you want to do it to be integer, it's called integer programming. But it's very easy in Excel. You can just click on solver, and then you add another constraint that of this has to be integer. Okay. So you just add another constraint that of these variables has to be integers. That's it. You said okay. And let's do solve. Did you get the same thing?
Mm-hmm.
Good. Good, good, good.
Oh, no, I didn't. Actually, I got 50, 35, and 25.
Yeah, close.
Okay.
You are close. Yeah. Because sometimes in different computers, they have different algorithms for solver. That's why you get different results. It's something inside solver. So you get the idea?
Yeah.
Now you can solve it. You can change the objective function too. Instead of adding all this up, you can maximize your revenue and then see how it's going to change your problem. Instead of adding, you can have X1 multiplied by the price of iPod, and then X2 multiplied by the price of iPhone, and add it all up and maximize that. You can change the objective function too. And you can do what is called a sensitivity analysis, which means that if you decide to buy a new machine to produce all this product, how is it going to change your problem? Okay, let me copy this down first. So this is our solution. It's spatial and values. Let's say I have a new machine that I can buy, and the available time here in machine 3 is going to be 300 instead of 150. Okay, so just change the available time here. Okay, see how is it going to change your result here. That is sensitivity analysis. When you change something, how is it going to affect your solution? Then you do the same thing. You don't have to do anything. You just do solver. Click on solver. Solver has all the objective function and the constraint. Then you do solve. Then, what did it say? You cannot do something else. This has the same solution. How about I change it here to be 800. Machine A. Then solve again. Now, the decision changed. See? Okay? So you produce. So the original one will be producing this, but now you change. You produce much more on the iPhone. Okay? Any questions so far?
So basically what the first change is telling us, when we change from 150 to 300 and didn't change, what's the meaning of that?
I think because so which one did I change first? 300, right?
Yes.
I think because you don't really use this machine 2 and 3, right? You just use 2 and 3 of them. When you add some more time for it, then it doesn't change. But you use a lot of machine A. See? So if you increase the time here, then it might change your problem. Yes.
Okay.
I'll change this.
Yeah, you can change to be.
Oh,
and then do solver.
So you just change it to solver.
Yeah.
I'm going to go there. I don't get it to my classroom. Because I change this to default for all the
students. Yes. Maybe you do something with solver. For this, maybe you modify something else. But that's minor. You get
the idea. Those are heavy values.
Maybe I should do a hop. Okay, I have 20 minutes more. So I'll do the portfolio optimization.
Oh.
Okay?
Yeah.
Have you done it before?
Yeah.
Yeah? In Excel?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
What's that picture?
It's like, how much should you pick the stock into your portfolio? Have you done it before?
No.
Okay, let's just do it.
Portfolio
optimization. Here we go. So Mr. Warren Buffett has been studying three stocks, right? J&J, GE, and especially AIG. He has estimated the expected return of 15, 12%, and 9% for J&J, GE, and AIG. Okay. And then his goal is to minimize the volatility of his portfolio. Okay. Volatility is like, it's go up and down, right? Your portfolio value is go up and down. But if you go up like this, then you have a higher volatility. And he's demanding. He wants to get at least 10% expected return for his portfolio. So you know what the portfolio is, right? If you have a bunch of stocks together, then it's called portfolio. But each stock might have different number of shares, and the value for each holding will be different. So the covariance of the return of the stocks are as follows here. Okay. So the covariance means that if it's positive, it's a big positive number, that means two stocks will go together when they move, right? But if it's negative, one might go positive, one might go negative, go to different direction. Have any questions? Yes.
How is it for whoever is matches over GE and GE, it's 0.8 and not 1?
That one is the variance of the GE stock, the return.
Okay.
Yeah. So, from this matrix, J&J and GE here, this one is the covariance of J&J and GE. Okay? And you can see that if you flip the matrix right here, the covariance is the same thing. See, J&J and GE, 0.02, same number here. And then when you do J&J and AIG, minus 0.2, same thing, right? And on the diagonal here, should be what? Should be the, yeah, it should be the variance. So this one should be the variance of the J&J stock, the return. This one should be the variance of GE, right? This one should be AIG. So Mr. Buffett had $1 billion. How should he allocate his money into each stock, given these problems, given these conditions? Okay, are you ready to solve it? All right, let's do it. Okay. So,
it's fine.
Okay, so what is random here? What is the random variables here?
You took stats already.
Huh?
Price.
Yeah, it's the price, but in terms of this problem, it's the return, right? The return is just the price at the end divided by the price at the beginning, right? So it's the same thing. So your random variable is R1, R2, and R3, right? Okay. Now you want to form the portfolio. Your portfolio will consist of these three returns, right? And consist of, let me call this JNJ, GE, and AIG. So the first one will be XJNJ, R, hat. Okay, so X will be your decision variables. Same as the last problem, that X will be the amount of producing iPad, iPhone, and iPod, right? Remember that? Good. And then you do, XGE, RGE, this should not be had. And then XAIG, and RAIG. I use the hat there because I want to specify to be random variables. That's it. Don't be panic. Like, oh, what it is. And then the objective function just gonna be minimized, right? He wanna minimize his volatility. Okay? So he wanna minimize the variance of his portfolio, right? Volatility is just the variance of the portfolio. So the variance here is going to be variance of XJNJ. Let me call it XJ, RJ, XG, RG, plus XA, RA. Right? You just substitute this value into here. Right? Get it? Good. No questions?
Question.
Then you apply the variance formula that you have learned. Should be what? Xj square, right? Because Xj is like number, right? That you wanna put it into this stock. And then variance of RJ, correct? Plus XG square variance of RG plus XA square variance RA square of RG. Sorry. And what else? Two covariance, yes. Yeah, you need to multiply by the decision variables too. So it's going to be XJ, XG, variance of RJ, covariance. Oh, it's boring, huh? All the formula. And then two, X what? J, XA, yeah. Variance of what?
RJ,
RA. And then plus X what?
XG.
G, XA, right? RG, RA. Whew, tedious. Okay, but this, you can try to derive it at home, and then you will see it's right.
Okay, what else?
So this is your objective function. Don't forget that. You try to minimize this whole thing. Okay? Subject 2. Can you read it? Can you read it? Subject 2. Your expected return of your portfolio, RP, which is going to be expected of what? XJ, RJ, plus XG, RG, plus XA, RA, has to be what?
Yes.
This is expected.
This is his demand, right? Mm-hmm. He wants it to be at least 10% of the return of the portfolio. Wow. Then you can simplify, right? Mm-hmm. Simplify this formula here. Which is going to be xj expected of rj plus xg expected of rg plus xa expected of RA has to be greater than or equals to 10%, right? For expected value, you can just bring out the constant. Why do I have to do this? Do you know why? I have to simplify this to this. Why do I have to simplify this to be this?
I mean, we need the stocks that gives us the higher return.
Yeah. Because, yeah, we want to find X here, right?
Yeah.
So that the expected return for the whole thing will be greater than or equals to 10%. And this expected here is given by us. That's all the numbers. Right? The expected return for each stock is given by us. Okay? And then, since you have only $1 billion, only $1 billion, so you cannot, yeah. When you add it up, what it should be? Should be 1 billion, right? The money that you put in for each stock has to be 1 billion, okay? And then what else? Ooh. Okay, that's it for now. So you get the idea?
Yeah.
That's...
So do you have the condition that this amount is...
Yeah, I want to get that. Oh, you are far ahead. I just want to show first that some of them might be negative, and then I'll show that he wants it. He doesn't want to short the stock.
Yeah.
Does he assume that he has to keep this, he spend all the 1 million?
The
1 billion.
Yeah.
Yes.
All the 1 billion.
What is shorting the stock?
Hmm?
What is shorting the stock?
Shorting the stock. What is shorting the stock?
Ooh.
The process of shorting the stock is, if you are an investor, you borrow a stock from someone else and you sell it. So you will make money if stock goes down. You do the opposite of investing.
Oh.
Yes. Yes. Exciting. Yeah. Okay. All right. Let's do it.
I haven't shown stock either, so I want to know shorting stock.
So all the covariance is given here, right? So let's just go to the optimization problem 2. Okay. So, what do we do? We need the decision variable, right? Let's say you want to put in 0.5 for J&J. Again, you guessed it first for solver. And then you want to do maybe 0.3 and then 0.2 for AIG, okay? And then when you sum it, when you sum the whole thing, should give you what?
One,
right? Okay. And then your expected
return of the stock. Do you get this? The first one, the first column here, do you get any question so far? No, right? Okay. For the expected return, you just do this, right? Multiply by what you have, right? The same equation as the expected return of the portfolio. Okay? Okay. And then you do the same for all. And then you sum it up. So that's your expected return if you put this much into each stock. Okay, so that is your expected return of the portfolio. Okay? You get the idea here? Okay. But the tedious part is the variance. Portfolio. Right? The variance of the portfolio. The best thing is to do this first. Call this to be varj. That'd be underscore varj. Let's define first that the variance of J and J is here, right? When you plug it into the formula of the variance of the portfolio, it will be easier for you to put it in. So let's call this var J, okay, var of the J and J, okay? And then call this var of the G. Okay, do the same for this. That is var of the A. Okay, do you get that? Okay, and then this, since you need only three value of the covariance, because the covariance here will be the same, right? The value will be the same. So let's call it cov of J and G. Okay? Let's call this number cov JG. Yes?
Is the volatility the standard deviation of the portfolio or the variance of it?
It's the same thing because standard deviation is just the square root of the variance.
But
so
in the process of the minimization, won't that affect anything?
I don't think so.
Oh,
because it's an increasing function. Variance is an increasing function of the standard deviation. It's x squared, right? You square the standard deviation, you get variance. Yeah. So x squared is increasing. Yeah, it's increasing from 0 to infinity. Because x squared is like this. But it should not matter. I know. Yes?
Okay, and for the variance, where are you going with diagonal or straight down?
Should go to the
diagonal.
Because the covariance of GE and GE is the variance of GE.
The expected
return. Oh,
okay. Okay. Then this one is going to be cov J and A, right? This one is going to be cov of G and A. Good. So you get all the variables to calculate the variance of the portfolio. Now let's do it. Can you guys follow?
Yes.
Let me do 5 more minutes. We can take a break. Did you get all the variables?
Yes.
Okay, let's do covariance. So it's gonna be the decision xj, right? Look at the formula. Xj square multiplied by variance of the j, right? Mm-hmm. Plus
This is tedious. G4. Yeah. Multiply by variance. G. AIG. Square. Multiply by variance. Of what? Of what? A? Correct? Plus 2 times xj times xg times covariance of xj and g. jg plus 2 times j times AFG times co of, well, J, A, and then the last term, 2 times GE times G5 times co of GA.
Can you
okay.
Leave that right there first?
Yes. So, the first one is the variance of the J and J, right? Multiplied by the square of this decision variable. Okay, from the board, it's just the board. So it's G3 square times variance of J, right? Then G4 square times variance of G, G5 square times variance of A, variance of AIG. And 2 times the cross. Now the cross, the first one here is the J and J and GE. It's 2 times decision of J and J and GE. Okay. If you cannot follow this, you can do it like tonight. just look at it. I just wanna finish it and then you guys can go to break. Okay? But the idea is just to get the variance of the portfolio, okay, from that formula. Okay, I think that's all you have to do for Excel, okay? Just remember you need to calculate the variance of the portfolio. Then you go to solver, okay? Then what is your target cell now? What should be your target cell? The objective function, what is it? The variance, right? Yeah. So it should be G9. This one. You want to minimize your variance of the portfolio, right? Okay. And then you change from maximize to be minimize. Okay. You want to minimize your variance. By changing what? Help me.
Decision
variables, right? You want to minimize xj, xg, and xa, right? Which is this, correct? Then enter. Now your constraints is what? You want to sum of this to be what? To be 1, right? So you just add this guy, right? This guy is the sum of this. Correct? Mm-hmm. To be equals to 1. Right? Did you get this constraint?
Wait, so you want the variance to be, wait.
You want all the decision variable, you sum it up to be equals to 1.
Oh, okay. So
right?
Right.
You have only 1 billion.
Right.
You want us. How much should I put in for each? Yeah, 1 billion. And then you click add.
Oh, I got it.
So everyone can follow this?
Mm-hmm. Let me know if you have any questions.
And then what is the other one? The other one is your expected what? Expected return of your portfolio has to be greater than or equals to 10%. Mm-hmm. Right? So this is your expected return of your portfolio. Then greater than or equals to what? 0.1, right? 10%. Then you click OK. And then you solve it. That's it. Good. So that's what you have to do. Your interpretation of this is that you want to put $330 in J and J, and $397 for GE, and $272 for AIG.
Right, I'm getting something else.
You are.
Maybe your variance. This little bit of variance.
Yeah, this one might change your result. You need to check if it's right. Because I got the same thing when I did it. Sometime I mismultiplied something.
You have a question?
Yeah. Yeah, maybe something. You might mismultiply something.
You check it out.
This.
So, but you get the idea, right? If you don't, sometimes you will get like negative number of the decision here, right? That means you want to short the stock, right? You want to bet against the stock. So he said that he wants to long the stock, which means he wants to buy it, not selling it. So you can add another constraint. You add it. What do? If you don't want to short the stock, yeah?
So greater than 0.
Greater than or equal to 0? Which one is greater than or equal to 0?
The return.
Decision variable. Each of
them. Decision variables.
Right.
Okay. Because if the money that you put for each is negative, that means you want to short the J&J. But if it's positive, that means you want to put that money into J&J stock. So let's do this. Decision has to be greater than or equal to 0, okay? But I suspect that it's not going to change the problem it's not going to change the solution because the solution already have positive number. So we long all the stocks already. It's not negative. Let's solve it. So same answer. Okay, so I just finish here, and then if you guys have any problem, then we can talk about it later. But let's go have a break, and then we will come back at 3:30. Okay? All right, thank you. So any questions?
Yes.
Yes.
I looked over this formula and it seemed right to me that I didn't find any mistake.
Just make sure that you have the right formula.
Okay.
And you do it next time.
Oh. All right. Okay.